Greetings to all our wonderful viewers. From the set of choices, we trust God you are enjoying your family as you celebrate the birth of Christ. We want to say thanks to you parents, especially fathers, for spending quality time with your children. Those children are looking for a role model, and you can be the best role model. Don't allow it just to be for this season, but allow it to continue as long as they live. I want to say thanks to our bishop, the leadership of First Assembly. Thanks that we were able to be a blessing not only to our community, not only to members and friends of this fellowship, but even for them. You know, this season, Christmas, is all about giving. I'm reminded clearly of John 3:16, a passage that you are so familiar with, a time of giving. But the part I love about that is that God gave his only begotten Son. In those days, the olden days, before Jesus was manifested in the flesh, the people, they were living in darkness. They walked in darkness. They sat in darkness. But I thank God that they saw a light. They saw hope. They saw the real reason for the season. They saw the real reason for living. That light that they saw was the Lord Jesus Christ. They were living without hope. As far as I'm concerned, they were just going through the motion of living. But then they saw that light, and it brought a difference. It made a difference in their life. This light is available. God, who is no respecter of person, sent this gift, his only begotten Son. And I love about it is that he is available to every one of us, regardless of ethnicity, religion, whoever you may be. The Bible says, for God so loved this world. This world includes you. Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. Children, you're looking at this program. You are precious. You're valuable. And you're priceless in the sight of God. And so, we want you to accept this light. Jesus said, he said, I am come as the light of the world. I am come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. So, we want you to enjoy life. We want you to live a productive life. We want you to live a life that is right and pleasing in the sight of God. And so, we challenge you. The wise men follow that star. They follow the light. If you follow Jesus in all your decisions, in everything in life, you will never grow wrong, never go wrong. So we want to say, this light is available. Accept this light and your life would be different. Shalom.
We are in the most wonderful time or season of the year. The time, the season that we are celebrating the birth of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So Christmas is about light. Christmas is about hope. It is about the liberation of all mankind. That is why Jesus came, so that we could be set free. As the scripture says, he who the Son sets free is free indeed. In John 1:14, it is recorded that the Word became flesh and moved into the neighborhood, or neighborhoods, moved into community, the community. And so Jesus was about, the ultimate purpose was the liberation of all mankind through salvation. We receive salvation by the shedding of his blood. So he came that we may have life, and life more abundantly. But Jesus also recognized that as a person, we are made up of body, soul, and the spirit. And so he did not just address the issue of the spirit, the salvation of mankind, but he addressed the whole issue of the soul also. And that deals with the whole idea of empowering mankind. while we live on this earth so that we could be empowered. He addressed economic and the social needs. In other words, I could say that Jesus understood something about felt needs. You know, felt needs, basically people look at the community and you map what that community might need for the community to be to take off, for the community to be empowered, for the community to be lifted up. And so Jesus was not just about preaching, but he addressed the felt needs that persons had in different communities, like feeding the 5,000, clothing, and people, you know, whatever situation they were going through, they were sick, and so he healed them and so on. And even as a church, as a fellowship, we are happy and pleased to note that, like Jesus, in terms of observing the felt needs, as a fellowship, we moved into the community, into communities, by the provision of baskets over this COVID period. People had needs. We recognized that there was a felt need. And so as a fellowship, we packed goods and delivered to people in different communities, in Wortmanville, in Sophia, in Hope Tongue in Borbis, in Parfait, across the river in Region 3. So people came and they received, and people were blessed. And, you know, from the reports that we got, people really felt that what we did touched their hearts, so much that they continuously looked to see when this will happen again. And people could only operate in that manner or in that fashion if they have a need. And so we were happy, like Jesus, to move into the communities. And, you know, the Word became flesh and moved into the communities and meet those needs of those people. And so we want to say thanks to all those who would have contributed in making that program a success. Like Jesus, we need to continuously move into communities so that we could impact the lives of people. Gentlemen.
In thanking the members and friends of First Assembly, who is coming alongside First Assembly, the bishop and the members and friends of First Assembly, in blessing families and meeting felt needs. We are meeting felt needs. I would also like to thank the dozens of volunteers for the act of volunteerism in packing and distributing to hundreds of families. And this could only be possible because of the great example that our Lord Jesus Christ gave to us. There is an account in John 11 where Jesus, having heard about the death of Lazarus, when he saw his friends Mary and Martha weeping, being who he is, a man who is in touch with people, a man who responds to people, the Bible said Jesus wept. And so he is a man who is touched with the very feelings of our infirmities. And he doesn't only leave it to that point, but the Bible also spoke about him telling them to remove the stone from his tomb. And then he later spoke the word, Lazarus, come forth. So we are so grateful for those examples. And as a community, as a church, we want to encourage all of us to continue to partner with First Assembly and be a blessing, not only to our immediate community, but we also want to encourage you, be a blessing to your family, encourage somebody, be a blessing every single day. Let us find a way to be a blessing to somebody every single day.
Element of the community. While we were being a blessing, you know, how Dr. Hudson described the community, but There's an element that we observe is that we have Haitians, we have Venezuelans, and we have Brazilians who are here and become part and parcel of our community. And I was overjoyed that they also benefited. And the Brazilians would say, I think it's something like obrigado, meaning thanks. I hope I got it correct. The Venezuelans would say muchas gracias. Well, the Haitians spoke broken English, but said thanks nevertheless. So the point in all of this is that our community is not limited just to Guyanese or persons within the immediate vicinity of the church, but we have been able also to touch persons who, for varying reasons, have had to leave the land of their birth and Guyana. So they similarly benefited. And that is the whole, the crux of Christmas. When in Luke, the angel spoke about, the great joy to all people, referring to all humanity. And so I was really happy that we were able to bless all humanity in the sense of all those who are in our geographical space.
Well, I really thank you, Pastor Lee, for making mention of the angel's comments, because it is an announcement that the word that became flesh, behold, I bring you great tidings, good news. And that's what Jesus represents, that change in mindset, that change in position, that change in lifestyle, even that change in the needs and demands that we have. And throughout scripture, as Jesus traversed the earth, you heard him always consistently saying, the kingdom of God has come, or the kingdom of heaven has come. And it is that new culture, that new behavior, that new rulership and governance that we have been exposed to as a result of the birth of Christ. And it is for that reason we act the way we do, we feel the way we do, we minister the way we do, because that's what Christ came to do for all of us. And so we all are involved, all are consumed. That's why we do the things we do for Christmas. And we can't even do it just for ourselves. I'm sure you called somebody and helped somebody, give them a piece of black cake, some chicken, a little food, those kinds of things, because we represent bringing that joy into the lives of others because of Christ.
Reverend Asana, I thank you for the input, but I want to add to it, because Luke made mention in the second chapter, verses 13 and 14, that this announcement, it would have impacted two realms. Glory to God in the heavenly heights, and peace to all men and women on earth. So the two realms were impacted by the appearing of this child that was born to save the world from sin. And the Christmas goes beyond the blinds and the curtains and the garlic poke and the pepper pot, and of which we will all partake of. But we are more emphasizing the birth of the Christ child, Savior of the world, that we are all benefiting from. So Merry Christmas. Merry Christ-centered Christmas to everyone.
You know, as we continue to share about the goodness of Jesus Christ and his birth, and what it means to us about giving, he gave his life eventually for us, we know. Reverend Singh also mentioned being a father in this period of time, in this season. What does it mean to be a father? And one of the names Isaiah did proclaim, that Jesus Christ would be called his everlasting father. You know, what does it mean to be an everlasting father? You know, and who is a father in this season? I would like us to take a different look or a clearer look at a father. And the father is the one who provides. You know, a father is the one who defends, he intercedes. And most importantly, the father loves his family. Jesus Christ do love us. We are aware of this. We know this. We keep proclaiming this every day, every week that we meet here. The everlasting father, he cannot die. You know, you may be saying, I don't have a father in this season. How are you telling me about a father looking after me and looking after my family and looking after the family? But we have an everlasting father in Jesus Christ. He is there for us. He loves you. He's interceding for you. He's interceding for me. He's interceding for all of us. You may be saying, oh, in this season of COVID-19, we can't run away from that. We need to keep mentioning it. You know, in this season, this is a season of mourning. There's no joy, there's no peace. You were speaking about peace. There's no joy, there's no peace. But yes, we have an everlasting Father who intercedes and who loves us, who protects us. You know, Romans 12:15 tells us we need to mourn with those who mourn, and we need to rejoice with those who are rejoicing. So those who are rejoicing today because they have joy, and there was no death or no negativity in their life for this year, bless God. But as we're rejoicing and as we're celebrating, be cognizant of the brother who's mourning. Let us understand who's in mourning. Let us empathize with that brother, as Pastor Paul mentioned earlier. You know, so as we celebrate, let's be sensitive to them. If you're struggling, you don't have to struggle alone. We have the everlasting Father who can help us, who can guide us, who loves us, who intercedes for us. So I give him to you again once today, the everlasting Father who cannot die. So yes, you have a Father as well in this season who will protect you, who will look after you.
Well, you know, Minister Kurt, it's amazing. I'm looking at you and you are speaking those words from a very cold environment. And the Christmas... the Caribbean singers, historically, I've never seen a white Christmas and all of those kinds of songs they sang. But there you are in Switzerland, and it looks as though the place is cold. May I assure you, Christmas in Guyana is warm, you know. May I assure you, rejoice with us. As you just said, you know, if your brother, you enjoying the cold, but we really thank God, and I really appreciate the fact that throughout this pandemic, there's such responsiveness from young men when we started with the 25% of the capacity of the building in terms of worship. Young men like Limar and Aubrey and Shamar and all the others, but a Mason who would come Sunday after Sunday and they would record names, take body temperatures, and help with the assistance of making sure folks are seated, Deacon Fitzroy and all the others, the brothers who operate the sound system. It's just amazing that all they were making it possible for all of us to be able to be in the house of the Lord in a safe environment. And we think about what John saw, you know, John chapter 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the same was in the beginning with God. And we think about John writing that and coming to verse 14 when he said, according to the Message Bible, and the Word became flesh and blood and moved into our neighborhood, right where you live, right where I live. And we see that during the season. Whereas humans, we reach out to touch each other. A smile, a neighbor passing a cake over a fence, or some meal or just an exchange. Hi. And it's amazing. When Jesus comes into the neighborhood, there is a calm. There's tranquility. There is peace. And in the midst of struggle and war, we need that kind of atmosphere. And we can't forget, again, Matthew said, one of the reasons why he came, his name shall be called Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. And I muse, you know, that perhaps if Isaiah and Micah and even these New Testament writers were to return, and they see how we celebrate the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, they might want to know what book we're reading from, because they would be surprised that lots of the things we do culturally don't line up with the original intent. We want to wish you, notwithstanding all of these things, Jesus came to give us life and to bring light into our beings. A Merry Christmas to all of you, wherever you view this program from.
And a Happy New Year. So I like to bake. And over this season, I've done a lot of baking. And something that came to my attention, or that I really got an interesting insight about, was the yeast. You know, when you mix yeast and sugar and flour and everything to make your bread, you have to cover it in a position and wait for it to rise. And if the place isn't warm enough, it wouldn't rise. So what I'm saying, why I'm telling you this or giving you this reference, is that many of us have been trying to, over this year, 2020, we've been mixing in the yeast with the flour and the sugar and everything, but it wasn't rising because the place was too cold, right? The environment wasn't right. The environment was a little toxic, right? But in this new year, I don't know if you could feel it, but I could feel it. There's been a change in the environment, so that many things that you've been trying to do over the last year, over the past few seasons, the environment could now be right for them. And if you look in the newspapers, if you pray a lot, if you just look at the different trends that are going on, not only in Guyana, but across the world, the environment is changing. So it's important for us to open our eyes, be vigilant in 2021, and mix in your yeast, you know, mix in your yeast and ensure that you position yourself in a place where, as the environment changes and gets warmer, that you also will rise. And I believe that there's also scripture that highlights it's not a lot of yeast that you need in order to bring about change. It's just a little bit, you know, just a little bit of yeast that you need to bring about a massive change. So that's just my little inspiration shout out for 2021. And let's see how great we could be this year.
Jesus said in John 6:51, he said, "I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I will give for the entire world." Now, Jesus is about world salvation. You know, sometimes when we celebrate Christmas, people believe that we are speaking about a particular group of persons, maybe those who call themselves Christians. But clearly, the world is made up of people of different races, of different views, different beliefs, and so on. And this Jesus is saying that I give my life for the entire world. So it means that if you are a Muslim, if you are a Hindu, whatever religion you are for, you must understand that the death of Jesus Christ, and this is by his own admission, he said, "I give my life for the entire world." So in his kingdom, what Jesus is saying is that I am not looking at people. I am looking, I'm not looking at what religion or what connection people have. I am looking at it from the perspective that all of you I died for. So everyone, each and everyone or anyone could come to me and receive that salvation. So Christmas is about world salvation for every person, your friends, your family, everyone. And by his own admission, he said, "I died for you."
Well, what a love, what you think about. we think about the whole notion of what you've just said, and we compare it with Matthew's account of the wise men. These wise men were pagan in their belief. The Judaism did not have any place for astrology, but it is through the practice of astrology that these wise men were able to see the star and discerned that this star represented the birth of a king. Now, no one pushed back. These were the only men who, at the very first recognition of his universal coverage, it took Jesus beyond the realms of Judaism, beyond the realms of the Jews. When you had pagan intellectuals coming to say, "Where is he who is born king?" And the scripture says they worshipped him. They worshipped him. As we are standing on the threshold of 2021, Joshua.
Glory to God in the highest. Hallelujah. We should be all grateful for being here this day. 2020 has taught us to be grateful. And we've been encouraging you to be prayerful. Pray for safety. Pray for your family. Pray for your loved ones. And even call upon God to pray according to Malachi, that the Lord will turn the hearts of the fathers to their children and the hearts of the children to their fathers.
With our 13 seconds to go, we ran into some difficulties with our brother's internet. And so we want to wish you
stay home.
A Christ-centered 2021. May you find focus in him. May you have a heart of a lion. Be courageous. May you have the vision of an eagle. And all of us, the touch of a human, so we'll be able to relate to each other and together work and honor God. We'll see you next year. God bless you.
I'm Salacia on behalf of the seven. Mind you that your whole life is the sum of your choices. God bless you.
Jack Frost nipping at your nose. Yuletide carols being sung by a choir. And folks dressed up like Eskimos. Everybody knows a turkey and some mistletoe.